Having fun with that. Hope y'all liked it. We did. We'll ask Pastor Israel to come right now. Today, they've called for National Day of Prayer, and we know we've got plenty to pray about, but we'll have Pastor pray for us right now.
Y'all can be seated. Somebody saw that. You can turn the lights on, too. So I'm just going to educate you for just a second on this coronavirus. The reason that people are canceling, the reason that things are happening the way they are is not for panic, not for pandemonium. And I saw this last night. A nurse had posted it, and it's the truth. It's not because people are getting hysterical or because they believe the virus is deadly or they're panicking. It is because we only have so much capacity to deal with a lot of very sick people at one time. If we can delay the spread by keeping people away from each other, we have a chance to help more people effectively and not overwhelm hospitals and infrastructure. There are only so many nurses, doctors, hospital beds, and pieces of equipment to help people that may eventually get virus and related to pneumonia. So please share that. This is not the CDC's way of getting everybody to rush out and just go panic, go crazy. This is their way to just say, we're trying to keep it from spreading. We're trying to keep it from happening to hospitals and nursing homes, especially where the elderly are. The media, however, has put everybody into a state of pandemonium. And that's just, I read another post that said if the media were quarantined for 14 days, 90% of our problems would go away. So, do you remember Y2K? I remember a radiologist that went to China and bought every diesel generator he could find. And he was going to make his fortune selling diesel generators, and he was going to retire. Y2K. Do you remember Ebola? Do you remember the bird flu, the swine flu, all these things? We have lived through 10 end of the worlds. We've lived through them already. I remember after 9/11, I sang a song at Downing's Creek, and it said, in a world filled with doubts and confusion, it's so hard when you don't understand. Oh, but I'll stand on a solid foundation, and I'll hold to God's unchanging hand. Sing with me. And the sun's coming up in the morning. Every tear will be gone from my eye. This old clay's gonna give way to glory. And like an eagle, I'll take to the sky. You know, the very worst thing that we think could happen would be the best thing for all of us. We'd get to go to heaven. That's what we think maybe the worst thing is, we'd get pneumonia and die. Oh, my goodness. But we'd never hurt again, not even have a Band-Aid on us. Stay right where you're at. You don't have to come to the altar, but let's pray. I'm going to lead us, and you pray in your own seat right where you are for all these things that we've mentioned. There's so many things and so many needs in our area, but let's pray for our nation, our country, and the people here. Let's pray. Father, we thank you, Lord, for a day that you've given us, Lord, to come to your house. Lord, we know that our numbers are not few, God, but the people that are here, Lord, give them a blessing that they counted a good thing and thought to come to your house today, Lord. And I pray, Jesus, for the decisions that are being made all across our nation, all across our country, even yesterday in our capital of Raleigh, that the governor said, you know, no meetings over 100 and no school for 2 weeks. Lord, help the parents and the kids that are going to be home for the next 2 weeks. Some kids don't have internet. Some kids have parents, both parents work. And it's going to be hard. It's going to be hard for our nation. It's going to be hard for our state. It's going to be hard for the economy. Maybe not in the next couple of weeks, but in the next couple of months, we're going to see real suffering and real rebounding from this effort that the media, I believe, has just scared people into. Father, I pray, God, for those kids that will be home that sometimes they only have meals at school. They have breakfast and lunch at school. And I pray, Father, that as our church, that if anyone needs anything, that they could reach out to one of us. And this is our time to be the hands and feet of Jesus. This is our time to rise above the fear and have faith and go feed people that need food. God, I pray for the healthcare workers that will be going to work every day, no matter what. They're going to be at work every day, God, that you would give them wisdom, that you would just, God, surround them with your protection. Put up an extra blanket of protection around all these healthcare workers, the doctors and nurses and techs and the lab people that will be testing these people. God, just protect them so we can go through this, Lord. And we know that on the other side of this, God, that we'll be okay, that you have all this under control. You're still on the throne. You're still God. We still believe in you, and you're still in charge of all this. This was not a surprise to you. This is small. This is small compared to the plagues that you sent on Egypt, God. And I pray, Lord Jesus, that you would awake our nation to need you more, and God, that they would come and they would know that the reason, God, for all this is they just need to get back to you. God, that this might be the very thing that does it, is this virus that's worldwide now, that people would come to you and people would pray to you and people would get back on their knees. Father, we pray for all the needs that are in our church family. Father, I pray for him and for Carter. Lord, as we went yesterday to Dave's funeral, God, I pray, Lord, that you'd just surround him and Carter, God, with your arms of peace and comfort right now. Lord, speak life into them, God. And I pray you just be with little Carter, that you'd help him know how much you love him. That kid, Lord, has been through so much in 11 years. Give him peace and wrap your arms around him and just tell him, show him how much you love him by works of kindness through others, Lord, by your people on this earth, Lord. Help him know that there is a Father in heaven who loves him dearly. Father, I pray you go with us through this service today. And, Lord, you get glory for everything that's accomplished here today, God. We're here for you and you only. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you, Pastor. Let's stand again to our feet. You guys probably all know this one. Let's all sing this one together. From heaven. wonder if I drink of his fountains, the least of 10,000 I come.
Yeah. God, we come to you at this time. Lord, we're just asking for your blessing. We're just asking for you to continue to move about this place. Touch our hearts, touch our lives. These are worries, these are pains. Lord, give us your word this morning. Give it to us straight. Help us apply it to our lives in the way that we need it done. Lord, you know the need. Lord, we ask that you just be with this service and everyone in it, anybody watching online, that they would find peace and comfort at this time through you, through this message. Be with Stuart as he brings your word. Move him out of the way, and you speak to your people. All these things we ask and pray in your Son, Jesus' name. Amen.
Amen, amen. Good morning. I want to say it's an honor to stand and minister the Word of God. This morning, as we get ready to do things and have service, it's a little bit different than what we're used to having service. It's a little bit unusual, but I find it interesting because that 2 weeks ago is when they asked me to preach today. Now, 2 weeks ago, could anybody in here predict what would be happening today? Closing, and Walmart's closing. Now, I heard that Walmart in Blairsville, Friday, that 2 days ago on Friday, did more sales than they did on Black Friday in 2019. That's impressive. And I'm not going to get into it, but I still hadn't quite figured out the whole toilet paper thing yet. But and hopefully I won't have to. You know what I'm saying? Huh? But anyway, with all that being said, 2 weeks ago I was sitting right over there. And it was toward the end of the service, and Keith was up here preaching. And it was toward the end of the service, and it's just like, and if you've ever, you know, to say you hear God, sometimes that's misleading to people because they think they, you're talking about you hear some kind of voice, like I'm speaking to you now. That's not really how you hear God. You hear him in your heart. It's that still, small voice. But as I was sitting there, it was just like, this is what I want you to preach about the next time you get to preach. I said, okay. And then like 10 minutes later, it's like, Stuart, can you preach in 2 weeks? I was like, sure, I don't know what I'm preaching about. You know what I'm saying? I mean, God just lines those things up. But 2 weeks ago, I couldn't even begin to imagine that the things that are happening in the world are happening now, but they kind of line up with what that the Lord was having us to talk about today. And as we get ready to go, I want to ask you a question, and we're going to have Mike put up a picture right here. Do you ever feel like you're stuck in a rut? Now, some of y'all, when you look at that picture, he's like, I know just how he feels. I know how that old man feels. I felt like that this morning. Come on. So, huh? Get stuck in a rut. A rut is just, if you look up the definition of rut, it's just the idea of doing something over and over and over again until it is no longer productive. At one time, it may have been productive, but it's no longer productive. If you started out something, it may have been good, but if you continue to do the same thing over and over and over and over again, it can tend to get us into a place where that we are in a rut. Now, some of you know what I'm talking about when you say a rut. You feel like you're in a rut in your workplace. Anybody ever felt like that? Ever? It's just like, oh my gosh, what is going on here? It's the same thing day in and day out, over and over and over again. Some of you feel like that you're in a rut in your family or in your relationships, maybe with your wife or with your kids. It's the same thing over and over again. Anybody ever had one of those conversations, maybe not even out loud, but in your mind, it's like, oh my Lord, how many times I got to tell this kid? You know what I'm saying? It's the same thing over and over and over again. And we get in this place of a rut. Now, I did not come up with this, but I heard somebody use this before, and I thought it was a great thing. See if this makes sense to you. A rut, we understand what a rut is. If you look at that picture, it's where you've just been going through the same spot so many times, you just wear down and wear down and wear down. And somebody coined this phrase. Again, it was not me, but I really like it. It says a rut, all a rut really is a grave with the ends knocked out. A grave that just keeps on going and going and going. Maybe you don't know what I'm talking about. Maybe you're not in a rut. Maybe you've never been in a rut. I find that difficult to believe, but perhaps you're one of the few people. But most of us get in those places. We get in ruts spiritually, don't we? Come on, somebody. See, there's not that many of us, so you got to amen louder. You see what I'm saying? We get in ruts spiritually where we'll go through the motions, and it might have been good at one point, but now it's altogether unproductive, that our prayers are just the same old prayers, and we're going to read our verse of the day on our Bible app, and that's about as deep as we dig into the Word, and we don't even care if we understand that. It's checked off our list, and we're going about our lives, and we're just living in that rut. I didn't come here today to upset anybody, but you know, if they didn't do good work on the asphalt out there, some of you have probably could wear a rut in the road from where you drive out every Sunday morning, and you drive and you park in the same parking spot, and you walk in and you say hey to the same people, and you sit in the same chair. And if we could diagnose it, if we could get some CSI going on up in here, we could figure out by the imprint of your behind who sits where, because you sit in the same place every Sunday. We're happy that you're here. The question is, are you in a rut to the point that it is unproductive? The book of Psalms, chapter number 40, reads like this. Verse number 1, you don't have to stand. We've been up and down a couple of times, but I want to read the word right here. Psalms 40, verse 1, reads like this. I waited patiently for the Lord. Well, that's something right there very few of us can say amen to. We don't wait patiently. We might be forced to wait on God because you can't rush him up. But whether we wait patiently, that's our decision. I decide that. And I'm not too good at waiting patiently on the Lord. Or anybody else for that matter. But you know what I'm saying? He said, I wait patiently for the Lord, and he inclined his ear to me, and he heard my cry. Watch this. Think about the picture. He brought me up out of a horrible pit, out of the miry clay, and set my feet upon a rock and established my going. Do you see that? That God looked at here he was looking at the psalmist, David, and he says, David, I see that you are in a rut. I see that you're in a pit. You're in a miry clay grave. And he says that I cried out to God from the place of my rut, the place where I was stuck. And when I cried out to God, God heard me in that place. And verse 2 declares that he brought me up out of the miry clay and he set my feet on a solid rock. Amen. Aren't you glad that we've got a God whose arm is not short? That he can reach you wherever you're at. No matter how stuck you are, God can get you out of that place. Now watch this. But not only does he set your feet on the rock, but he says, and he establishes my going. Another way to say that is that God will not only get you out of your rut, but God will put you on a new path. Because if I get you out of the rut and leave it up to you, you're going to go right back in the rut. It's our nature to do that. That's what we do. We like things that are comfortable. We don't like change. And I've went the same way every time. I've sat in the same seat every time. I've had the same breakfast every Sunday morning for the past 50 years. This is what I do. And there may be nothing wrong with it, except that if it's a rut and if it's unproductive, then it might be you are stuck and you need to get out of the miry clay. It might be that you need to call on God and he will hear you and he can lift you up. Now watch this. He says, he set my feet on the rock and established my goings. God will set you on a new path. How many of you know you're changed after you've had an encounter with Jesus? I'm different. I'm not the same anymore. I'm not the same man that I was before I had an encounter with Jesus Christ, before I come into a saving relationship with him. Amen. That's not who I am anymore. Amen. He cut me out of that miry clay, and he has set me on a new path. Aren't you glad of that? But then watch verse 3. He says, and, so it's got to go together. It's not just that he gets you out of the miry clay. It's not just that he says, well, I don't want you going this way. I want you going this way. It's not just that he did those things. But watch this. And he put a new song in my mouth, even praise unto our God. And many shall see it and fear and shall trust in the Lord. He's put a new song in. Listen, he's not just about getting you out of the clay. He's not just about getting you on a new path, but he's also about putting a new mind in you. Amen, the mind of Christ. He's about putting joy in your heart. He's about giving you that peace deep down inside and that mercy. Amen. Because see, whenever that you're stuck in the miry clay, you might be singing one of them old songs about being stuck in the mud. Come on, you know what I'm talking about. But now I've got a new song about how I'm free. I sing a new song about how that I'm no longer chained. I'm no longer bound down to this rut of a life that I've been living, but I'm walking free in Jesus' mighty name. Glory to God. And following his instructions, he said he establishes my going. Isaiah 43, I want to read a couple verses there. Isaiah 43, verse number 18, it says, remember you not the former things, neither consider the things of old. Behold, I will do a new thing. Now it shall spring forth. Shall you not know it? I will even make a way in the wilderness and rivers in the desert. Remember you not the former things, neither the things of old. Behold, I do a new thing now. Can I read that one more time? Because I don't think somebody heard me. Remember not the former things, neither consider the things of old. Remember not the former things. See, there's some things that we need to remember, but there's some things that as a Christian, as a believer, you need to forget. You need to forget some of those old sinful days of living. Or were we all saved from birth? No? Some of us got a pass. I know everybody don't, but forget that lifestyle. We've got a new path in Jesus. He said, forget the things of old. I'm doing a new work in you. And not only forget that, he says, don't even consider it. Don't even think about it. Don't even let it enter into your mind. Now, I don't want to mess anybody up right now. I'm here to help you. I'm not here to hurt you. But I when I was thinking about this, and it's like, do some of y'all have self-control problems? I mean, like, if you start thinking about maybe a particular food or some kind of dessert or something. I'm not even going to say what it is, because if I say it, then I might trip somebody up. I'm not here to hurt you. I'm here to help you. Can I be honest with you? But are you one of those kind of people, you start thinking about it, and then you think about it a little bit more, and then the next thing you know, you're making up a reason to be going by and getting the ingredients for it, or picking it up, or, you know, whatever it is that distorted it, but to be eating on it, you know, anybody know what I'm talking about? You know what I'm saying? Well, that's okay for some things, but what the scripture said, don't even think about these things, because when you start thinking about things that are negative or wrong or bad or sinful, listen to me, it's going to start getting in your mind and it's going to start taking over, and then it's going to get harder and harder and harder until you get that mind cleaned out. Some of us need a spring cleaning going on in our brain today. Huh? We've been thinking negative, and my gracious, you listen to the news. Pastor done talked about it. You listen to some of this media stuff. There ain't no wonder we're getting all sour. We need to get some cleaning out going on up in here. Fear not, fear not, fear not. 365 times, that's no accident. No accident. Be not afraid, fear not. Some form of that is found 365 times in the Word of God. One for every day. But watch this. Neither consider, don't think about those things. Behold, I will do a new thing. Now it shall spring forth. Shall you not know it? He said, do you not even see it? God says, do you not see that I'm trying to do something new? But I love this last part, because we serve a miracle working God. I believe there will be breakthrough. Watch. I will make a way in the wilderness and rivers in the desert. That is a declaration of miracles. A way in the wilderness, that just simply means that there's no path through the wilderness. That's why it's called the wilderness. But now God says, I'm going to make a road right through that place. He said, I'm going to make a river in the desert. What? Desert, by definition, is it's a lack of water. You don't got a lot of water in the desert. But God says, I'm going to have it flowing in abundance in that place. Why is that important this morning, talking about being stuck in a rut? I'll tell you why. Because you might be looking around in your life and you say, I don't know how to get out of this. I feel stuck. You may be in a rut, not by your choosing, but because you think there's no way out. But can I tell you something today? In Jesus' name, there's always a way. He is my way. He is my way out. Nobody else might see a way out for you. You might not see a way out for you, but God will make a way. There's no song we used to sing, when there is no way, God will make a way. When I can't see up ahead, I still believe those words He said. I will go before you and I will be your guide. God will make a way. I believe that's true. Do we have any believers in that today in the house? God will make a way. Somebody's stuck in a rut. Meadowgrove may be stuck in a rut. Talking to Tyler a few weeks ago, talking about the praise team. Sometimes we feel like, sometimes we get into autopilot and we just sort of cruise along. Maybe you feel like that in your life. It's not what we're doing is bad. It's not what we're doing is wrong. It's just when you have it and it's on autopilot, you don't even have to think about it. In our new world, I heard about a guy got a ticket. Got a ticket for not driving his Tesla. You know, those cars, they drive themselves, right? He got a ticket, but you're supposed to be paying attention. He was asleep in the back. Somebody else, they had an accident, and I think somebody even died from it. This is a couple months ago. And the guy was playing video games while the car was going down the road, and some sensor went haywire, and then it like ran into a construction site on the side of the road. See, autopilot's fine as long as the road's straight and everything's good, but when coronavirus comes along, when the diagnosis isn't good, when they're cutting your hours because nobody's coming to the store, listen to me, autopilot doesn't work then. And we got to come back and we got to find ourselves, where is my foundation? And He is my foundation and He is my rock. I didn't have Mike put this up on the screen, but I did want to point something out. Jesus tells a parable of the publican and the Pharisee. Some of y'all remember that story. It says that two men went up. This is in Luke chapter 18. It says two men went up to the temple to pray, one a Pharisee and the other a publican. The Pharisee stood and prayed thus within himself, God, I thank you that I am not as other men are, extortioners, unjust, adulterers, or even as this publican. And I want you to watch what happens in verse 12. He says, and I fast twice in the week, and I give tithes of all I possess. So he is fasting and giving. And he's in the temple praying. Now, if you go back to Matthew 6, Jesus teaches us and talks about giving and fasting and praying. These are three foundational pillars of what we are to do as believers. Jesus talks about that. But whenever he's talking about this guy, he's talking about it, that it's not a good thing what he's done. He's praying. He's talking about how that he fasts. He talks about how that he gives. He talks about these things. But watch verse 13. It says, the publican, standing afar off, would not even so much as lift up his eyes unto the heaven, but smote upon his breast, saying, God, be merciful to me, a sinner. I want you to watch what happens in verse 14. He says, I tell you, this man went down to his house justified rather than the other. For everyone that exalts himself shall be abased, and he that humbleth himself shall be exalted. Can I propose something to you today? That the man that was the Pharisee that went up, I propose to you today that he was stuck in a rut. He said, I fast twice a week. That's who I am. He said, here I am in the temple. I'm praying. I give a tithe of all that I have. Every one of those things were good, but Jesus says he missed the mark. Why? Because he was stuck in a rut. We're glad you're here. We're glad you give. We're glad you do these things, but you need to be stirred in your soul. The gifts and the callings and the anointing of God on your life. Because otherwise you feel like that you're just in a grave with the ends kicked out. That rut that keeps going and going and going. Churches are not buildings. We know that. We recognize that churches are made up of people. So if a church is in the rut, that means the people in the church are in a rut. I challenge you today. I pray that God would stir up in you and do a new thing. That you don't roll out of bed dreading every day. That you wouldn't roll out, oh God, here we got to go back to church. No, but get excited about what God is doing in your life and in the fellowship of the believers here at Meadowgrove. Get excited about what God is doing, because God's about to do a new thing in the house. Anybody believe that with me today? We'll ask Tyler come. The altar's always open. But I'm not expecting or even asking you to come today. If you want to, feel free to. But the invitation time is this. I want to pray for you, but I want you to pray for yourself. I want you to pray for your marriage. I want you to pray for your children. I want you to pray for your families. I want you to pray for your mama and them. Come on, somebody. I mean, pray for the person that's sitting beside you. Pray for those that are not here today. Pray for those that are out in the community. Pray for those that are trying to take charge and lead and guide us through this, whatever. But I want you to pray for you, because God says that you and I are the change. God says, if I'm going to do a work, I'm going to do it through somebody. Well, who's somebody? Well, that's me. Who's somebody? That's you. God moves in and through us. Let's pray right now. Lord, I love you. I thank you so much. I would desire this morning, as Tyler would begin to sing, that you would stir up in me. I'm not going to ask you to start with them. I'm going to ask you to start with me. Start in me, to stir up in me. God, you know what kind of ruts that I can get in. You know what kind of places I can be stuck in. And it's time to do something new. It's time to do something different. Lord, I just pray, God, that you would begin in me. Start something in me. God, I pray you would start something in this church. God, begin to stir up in Meadowgrove. Lord, we don't want to stand on the sidelines and talk about making a difference, God, but we want to get out and be the difference, God. We want to be the hands and feet of Christ. We want to make an impact on people. Lord, I love you, God. I thank you, God, for even just filling your spirit today, God, that you would even still use me is astounding. God, I just ask that your will be done. In Jesus' name. Church, can we stand together right now as he sings again? If you pray right where you're at, if you want to come to this altar, that's fine too. But please, just pray, God, stir in me. stir up in me a new thing. I challenge you. I dare you. Say, stir up in me a new thing. I'm stuck. I'm tired of being where that I am. I want to do something new. I need to do something new. I have to do something new.
The Bible tells us God's word so true. The sweet Holy Spirit is promised to you. Sat upon Jesus. Form of a dove. When John was baptizing God's dearly beloved, sweet Holy Spirit, I'm down on my knees. Oh, in the valley, I'm sowing you seed, but I know I can make it, for I trust in thee, the sweet Holy Spirit. Falling on me, sweet Holy Spirit. Oh, how I love thee for being a comfort so many times and strengthening me. I could not make it across life's troubled sea if the sweet Holy Spirit should ever leave me. Sweet Holy Spirit, I'm down on my knees. I know in the valley I'm sowing you seed, but I know I can make it, for I trust in thee. Sweet Holy Spirit, don't ever leave me.
Hey man, Caleb's got a couple announcements. Y'all can go ahead and be seated. It's all you, bro.
Just a couple announcements and then one at the end. First off, all events at Metagrove right now, like all our Easter egg hunt, we're not canceling anything. We're not going to do that yet, but we are going to take a week-by-week approach. All events for the youth are on hold as well, and our plans moving forward are we'll be having Sunday morning service, but no Sunday school, having Sunday morning service in here, 11 a.m. like we have done this morning. Wednesday night service, we won't be having children's or youth, but we'll be having service in here at 6:30. Kind of similar to how we had service tonight, just a Bible study. Obviously, things are developing and ongoing. You know, as of Friday afternoon, we were supposed to be having school Monday, and obviously we've gotten today and we're not having school Monday. So things are developing, things are changing, and as a church body and as we have great leadership in place that is making decisions as we go through this, and we just ask that if you're going to be coming to church, use common sense. We're not panicking, but if you're sick, don't come. Wash your hands. All these things that we should have been doing well before this, any of this occurred. Do we have any other announcements? Because I have one announcement that needs to come at the end. Yes. Yes, and that reminded me, we will also still be having soaking prayer tomorrow evening, 6:30. Yes, soaking prayer will still be happening at 6:30 tomorrow. Okay, and then our last announcement. This has been a couple months in the making, and I want to thank our financial team and our deacons for making this happen. No need to raise your hands, but first, let's just think about it for a sec. How many of you here either have your checkbook on you now or over $50 of cash on them? Probably not many of you. If you're like me, never. I know all of our transactions, most of us, are done online or through a debit or credit card nowadays. I know personally the only checks I've written in the last year have been for tithing, so it makes it difficult if you forget your checkbook one Sunday morning or you forget to go through the ATM to get cash. And so we're excited to announce here at Metagrove that we are rolling out a digital tithing option. Soon there will be a link on our website, and after service today, the link will be on our Facebook. That will direct you to the giving site, and we're also providing a QR code, which I will say some people's phones, if you take the picture, it'll automatically take you to the QR code, or you may have to download a QR code reader app if you have a phone like mine. It just depends on the type of phone you have, but it's very easy to do. When you go out into the foyer on the right-hand side on the bulletin, there is the digital tithing QR code as well as a bowl full of those same QR codes so that you can just take it with you. That way, you know, maybe do it at home later. And so it's very convenient. We're hoping to make it easy. We're not saying you have to stop using your checkbook or stop using cash. We're just hoping to open up the option of preference to you. So first, you'll enter your tithing amount. You'll notice there's an option for reoccurring giving. If you choose that option, it's going to ask you on the Tithely app or website just to set up an account. It's very easy to do so, and you can set up, you know, first Wednesday of every month, second Thursday of every month. And so when you scan the QR code, this is what it'll look like. And so you'll enter your amount. It automatically goes to tithe. That's the only option. You can check the reoccurring giving box, which if you check the reoccurring giving box, that's when it'll start to walk you through. If you go to the second slide, you can see that's my name, my email. So now you'll have my email. And so then you can enter card number, bank information, or if you're fancy enough, you can use Google Pay. I will let you know there is a fee. It'll also give you an option to cover the fee. The fee is very small. It's 33 cents per transaction and 2.9%. So, for example, if you were to tithe $100, just to use a nice round number, it'd be Tithely would take $3.20 out of that. So it's a very small amount, and we're hoping that we'll see that be well covered easily. And as well, like I said, you have the option to cover that. And then once you have clicked through all that, you'll see, next slide, you'll see a confirmation. And so you can see I was our first tither. I gave $1 to test it out. So then it'll say you just click OK. It'll confirm it. And then it'll go to that last slide, and it'll show you that you've done that. And then it's going to send an email to whatever email you provide as a receipt. And so we will still be tracking that, and you'll still be getting the tax-deductible giving forms at the end of the year, whether it's combined through check and cash that you've given or with the Tithely app, or whether you choose to use Tithely. So today what we're doing, that way we're not passing the plate, we will have some of the youth standing at the doors to accept tithes today, or if you want to use the digital tithing option, you can go to the Facebook page. It's not on the website yet, but will be within the next week or two. And as well, like I said, on the foyer out there is a bowl full of the QR codes, or you can just scan it right off the bulletin. It's fairly simple. If you do have any questions, my phone number is in the bulletin. Feel free to text or call me or email me. But it's fairly simple. Once you scan it, you just go step by step through it. And we're hoping this will be a really good option here at Metagrove, and we've been working on it for a couple of months now. So, okay, thank you, Keisha. So the link is live on Facebook as well now. So if you go up to the top of Metagrove Facebook page, it is there for your convenience. Okay. Do we have any other announcements? Don't want to make sure I missed anything. Okay. I'll pray us out. Dear Lord, I just want to thank you for this day. Thank you for this beautiful morning, Lord, and just bring us all here together in fellowship with you to get a great lesson from Stuart. Lord, I hope we can take this into our weeks. Lord, we know that times can be scary, but we know ultimately, Lord, we have nothing to be scared of because you're in control, and that you are the ultimate physician, and you are providing for us greater than we can even imagine, Lord. Lead us, guide us, and direct us as we go out